People of Los Angeles, we're bringing the Trap Set live to you with a stellar lineup, including Fred Armisen of the 8G Band in Portlandia, Stella Mazgava of Warpaint, and the legendary Clem Burke of Blondie. It all goes down on March 2nd at the Steve Allen Theater in Los Feliz, and you can get your tickets by visiting our website, thetrapset.net, and visiting live events. Hurry up, they're selling fast. And now on to the show.
The Trap Set will always be available for free, but we rely on donations from our listeners. Please visit our website at thetrapset.net and click donate. Subscribe to our show on iTunes. And if you enjoy what you hear, give us a review.
This is Joe Wong. Welcome to The Trap Set, where each week we explore the lives of drummers. I want to play something for you.
I pity the fool. I said, I pity the fool. Well, I pity the fool.
You're hearing I Pity the Fool by Bobby Bluebland, featuring my guest, Jabo Starks on drums. Starks' work with Bland's sensational band caught the attention of a young James Brown during a pivotal phase in his career. Jabo is a stylistic chameleon who can jump from hard-driving shuffle grooves to Latin-infused backbeats to incredibly sophisticated syncopated funk jams. His addition to the band proved crucial to Brown's creative evolution as he progressed from traditional song forms to his own wholly unique style. During most of his tenure in Brown's band, Jabo shared drumming duties with last week's guest, Clyde Stubblefield. Their beats, which are among the most sampled in history, not only defined the funk genre, but were the building blocks of hip-hop. Starks left Brown to play with blues legend B.B. King in 1975. Occasionally, he reunites with other alumni of Brown's band to play packed houses around the world. He still resides in his hometown of Mobile, Alabama, and continues to perform every week. And now our conversation with one of the all-time greats, Jabo Starks.
There was, in our yard, we had an old upright piano that never knew what a tuning was.
Right.
And there used to be some of the guys that would come by and sit out and they'd start banging on it. And growing up, you listened to gospel, you listened to the blues, and a lot of folk want to call it now, they got a new good name there, rhythm and blues.
Mm-hmm.
But you hear the blues, and then you hear some country. You know, not a lot of pop at that time, you know. But that was basically what you heard.
Okay, so how did you get started?
As you know, I don't know if you know or not, Mardi Gras started in Mobile. Okay, there was, and this was back in the segregated years now. You have to understand, this was back in the 48, 49, you know. 50, you know, and then you had the two main high schools that was the two largest black high schools in Mobile was the Central High School and Mobile County Training School, and I went to Mobile County Training School. Then you had your marching band, and during Mardi Gras time, you know, everybody was going to Mardi Gras, and that was where it was, listening to the bands play. And I heard this drummer. I was still seventh, eighth grade, one of them. And I heard this drummer. And I mean, you have to picture and listen, think. If you've ever heard somebody that was in total command of an instrument, of playing, even though they had a complete drum section, when he didn't play, it was a lot different, but once he started back to his playing, you heard it, man. I mean, he was he was in command. And I heard it. I think I walked for about a mile and a half listening to him. And I said right then, I said, you know what? I'd like to be able to play like he's playing. And during the summer, they would have summer band practice to see who was going to play, who was going to make the band, right?
Right.
Well, I went over there for the practice, and the guy told me, said, the guys in the band were talking, freshmen don't make this band.
Mm.
Freshmen just don't make this band. Now, you listen, but freshmen don't make the band. And I just said, I'm going to make the band. And I made the band.
Yeah, are you the kind of person that if someone tells you you can't do something, then you're going to prove them wrong?
You never tell me that. Don't ever tell me what I can't do.
Right.
Because I'll try until I do it one way or the other. But now I made the band, but here's the other hitch. You have to wait on the uniform. This is so nobody gave, you know, you had to wait on whoever was your side to give up a uniform.
Yeah, were you small at that point?
Oh man, yeah. I was about like that at that time. In fact, when I went on the road, when I first, my first professional gig on the road, I was still about that size. I never gained weight until I stopped traveling and went back home.
As you became more and more interested in drumming and music, was your family supportive?
Oh, man, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, that was it. My mother used to tell me when I was first out, get out of here. If you hit on another one of my pans, I don't think you, when I finish, I don't think you hit on another one. And I had to go outside and, they knew that, I think within themselves, they knew that I wanted to play. And now they almost knew that I was going to play, because I never will forget up in Jackson, Alabama. It's about 70 miles. That's my mother's home. And my grandmother was there. And I spent time up with my grandmother. And I had friends that worked in I don't know if you know, ever heard of sawmills,
mm-hmm.
working the sawmill. And I had a real good friend of the family to make me a pair of sticks out of some planer wood, as you call it. He made me a pair of sticks, man. I never will forget that. Jose McKenzie made that for me. And that was...
How long did they last?
Oh, a long time. They lasted a long time. I don't even know. I don't know if I lost them somewhere, but they were made so I didn't break them, because I wasn't doing a lot of rim things then. So
yes.
I didn't break them. But he found out, how did guy knew how to make that set of sticks? But he whittled those sticks down and gave me that set of sticks.
And that was your first set?
Yeah. Yeah, I've been playing in the marching band with that set of sticks. That stick. Yeah.
So when did your interest in drums change to an ambition to make it into a career?
To tell you the truth, I never really thought I would play drums as a career.
What did you think you would do?
Huh?
What did you think you would do as your career?
No, my grandmother's whole thing was for me to graduate, go to college and graduate. And I still say this to this day. If my grandmother had lived, I would have finished college. I would have done that, because you just have to know the love that we had for each other.
Yes.
But that was what she wanted me to do. And she said, I don't care what school you want to go to, I guarantee you'll go. But I just want you to go. And I was going. I got through my second year, and she passed right at the end of my second year. And I didn't have the interest to keep doing it. And I was still playing locally, because I played in a little high school dance band. And I started playing. So I wanted to just keep playing. It was just in me that I just wanted to play.
Ow! Mama, come here quick and bring that licking stick. Mama, come here quick and bring that licking stick. Mama, come here quick and bring me that licking stick. Horns, mama, come here quick and bring me that licking stick.
So you say you went to a segregated high school. What did
you... Oh, you have to... Hey, you, wait a minute. I'm in the segregated years, baby.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, the schools were separate.
Did you have much interaction with white people as a kid?
I don't like the word white. I like Caucasian.
Caucasian.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. What it was is in Mobile, one of the largest Caucasian high schools was built five blocks from my house.
Yeah.
I could not go to that school. I had to take a bus and go across town to a school. But then again, when I was playing and I got to I interact with different Caucasian guys, man. You know, we would get, especially if you were playing.
Was that when you were a kid still, like in high school or later?
Yeah, was, well, in high school, I had a chance to through going up watching my up where my mother was working, I'd go up there and there were some kids that were, we would get together and just talk and carry on, play, but that's not musically, no. Mm-hmm. No. And then after that, my freshman and sophomore year in college, I was starting to play more and more, and I was playing with the local group, and then we were doing fraternity dances, and the fraternity dances had to be the Caucasian that you were doing, playing the fraternity dances. And we got to know some of the musicians. And some of the guys, they had a couple of guys said, hey, man, really, if you close your eyes, you didn't know who they were singing. They were some good singers. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you get through your second year of college and your grandmother passed away. What was your next step? Did you know what you wanted to do with your life at that point?
Play music, man.
Okay.
And at that point, I was playing fairly decent. I mean, in Mobile, it was said that, well, if you needed a drummer to play, call Jabo. And at that time, the club that was in Mobile, I told you that, well, the guys went in. If you went there, all of basically the name artists came through that club. And you had a lot of guys that owned the club would book as a single and take the house band, as they call them, take a band and put that band behind him. Mm-hmm. Behind that art. And I learned to play behind. I learned to play with, you know, I played behind a lot of guys, man. A lot of big time guys.
Was there a particular time when you really felt like you had come into your own as an artist or as a drummer?
I've never come into my own.
Yeah.
I never have yet.
Yeah.
I never have. You're always learning something. There's always another phase. As they say, the note never stops. It's not a tacit. It's always another note that can be played. You keep learning. When you stop learning, that's when it's time for you to give it up.
Mm-hmm.
When you stop learning, you never stop learning. Now that's the way I feel, because I can go out here today and I can hear somebody play, and when I listen to some other guys play, I'm listening to what you're doing, and you're learning something, and that's what I've done. And you ask questions of guys that were doing how I learned what I'm doing and the way I done by asking questions.
Yeah,
because if you don't ever ask, you won't ever know.
Watch me, watch me, I got it. Watch me, I got it. Hey, I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got soul and I'm super bad. I got soul and I'm super bad.
So let's talk about how you first became aware of James Brown.
Oh, well, we have to go back to Bobby Blue Bland.
Yes.
See, now that was the first road band I went on the road with. That was the best musical group I played with, buddy. I'm not lying. Now, I was playing with them, and James had been paying attention to us. When we would play different places, if he was there, he would sit back in the wings or somewhere that you know nobody knew it, and he would hear what he was listening. And he tried for a year and a half to get me to come play with his band.
Mm.
And it was not my intention to go nowhere. But that's where it started. He had heard me, and he would always send one of the guys that were working for him, tell him that, ask me if I wanted to come work with him. And I didn't want to do that. And then a couple of times, that's what it was.
What changed your mind?
I got married, and my first child, which we have two children, but when my daughter was born, I was with Bobby Bland, and then see, I wasn't really making $22.50 a night, and you have to pay your own hotel, but in a hotel, that's another thing.
No per diem.
Per who? You want to hum a few bars of that? Let me see if I know that. No, sir. No, sir. But then that's what it was, and I couldn't work, even though we were working 3, 4, sometimes 5 nights a week. I could not afford to just work by the night any longer. I had a family, and I had went to Bobby, and I told him, I need a salary, man. I need to know I'm going to get X amount of dollars per week. Because I got a family. Then he went back to the office and they said, well, we'll think about it. And I said, well, nah, I don't know how much time you're going to need to think about it. And then a month or so went by and I asked again. He said, well, I asked and the office said that they're not going to be able to do it. I said, okay. And at that time, James, where were we? We were somewhere and he sent one of his little guys that talked to me and said, Mr. Brown want to talk to you.
So he always had minions do his bidding for him.
Well, he never did come with himself.
Right.
You know, he would send one of the guys that were working for him to have you to come and, so he called me. He said, asked me to come. He was in town. We were in, where we were in the same town.
And this was when, 65?
This was 65.
Uh-huh.
And so I sit down with him. He said, I still want to know, I want to hire you to play with my band. And
what is it you think that he saw in you that made him so persistent?
I can't tell you that. I don't know.
Okay.
You can't see.
But he never told you?
He liked the style I was playing. And as far as I know, that's the only way I can explain that. He liked my style of playing. And then he said, well, I'll tell you what would it take for you to come over and play with me? I said, well, I got to have a salary. He said, that's no problem. He said, I'll double whatever they are paying you to come and play with me. And I'll pay you, work or don't work. You get that salary. And so I called him. He said, well, I got a ticket. I send you a ticket. You can fly and meet me. And I met him in New York. I had that little old funky set of drums. And next year. And when I joined his group, man, I went to the theater. He said, I said, hey, man, you get 5 guys sitting up there. He said, don't worry about them. You sit down, you sit in the wings, and you listen and see what's going on, see how the show is running down. So I did. So we had 5 drummers, man. After that, it was 4. It was 3 of us then. And I was starting to play, too. And then he heard Clyde, and he hired Clyde. And so Clyde got together, man, we got to get these guys away from him, man. It's just me and you, Jabo. I said, all right. I said, well, we just play what we play. And then all of a sudden, it was just the two of us. And that's the way it ended up. Clyde left before I did, but that's the way it happened.
Yeah!
This episode of The Trap Set is brought to you in part by Colectivo Coffee, handmade coffee since 1993. Check them out online at colectivo.com.
You and Clyde fell in together really quick. How would you characterize the difference between the way you play and the way Clyde plays?
Can't characterize it. Clyde is one of the funkiest guys I ever heard. He's raw. He's funky. He's a raw, funky drummer. You ask him, what are you doing? He'll tell you, I don't know. I'm just playing what I feel. And that's Clyde. Now, we sit there for all those years and play next to each other.
Did you ever have to talk about it or think about it, or did it just work? Did you just have that chemistry?
What were you going to talk and think about? It was the idea that he played what he played.
Yeah.
I played what I played. I could play what he played. He could play what I played. It was a complete difference in playing, though. I could never play the funk the way Clyde plays it.
Yeah.
I could never do it, and I never tried. Clyde can't play the way I play. We never tried that, but we could connect with each other. And then, like with James, he was wanting to be a little slick.
Yeah.
You'd be playing, and he'd point back at me, and I start playing, or I'll start be playing, he'll point back at Clyde. Clyde started that. That was one of the things that you did, but you kept it was kept going. That's the way it was done, yeah.
Can you describe what it was like to be in that band as far as like how James led the band?
You know, sometimes I'm asked that question. I don't know, man. I was in the band, and like I told him, and Clyde always looked at me and said, he don't figure out how I did it. Well, see, Jane would fine you.
Yes.
I never paid a fine. I never paid a fine in that band. I had a reason for not doing it. I respect Jane for what he did and how he did it. He was a businessman. Now, when you join that group, he sit down and just like we are, and he told you his rules. He told you what he wanted, what he didn't want. Now, if you can't do it, feel like you can, let's just shake hands and leave. But if you stay here and you don't do it like I ask you, I will fine you. Now, that's the way that went. And I think that was business. You know, it's his gig. You don't own a thing. You're working for him. So that was my understanding with him. And I told him off the bat when I said, "Now I don't pay fines." And he said, "Why?" I said, "Because in the first place, I'm working for you. You tell me what you want me to do, and I'll do it the best way I can. And the way you want me to try to do it, the best way you want me to do it. I play that the way." But I said, "Now, if it's any changes, you will do the changes, not me. It's not my gig." I said, "But if you ever take some money from me, I'm going to take three times that much back from you." And I meant that. I said, "Because when you take money, you're not taking it from me. You're taking it from my family, and I don't play that." And Jab, you're all man. I respect you. I said, "Well, I'm being truthful, and I never paid a fine. That's what I never did it. You know."
So you had to just lay it out like that, and he respected it.
I don't know any other way to do it. Yeah. I tell you straightforward. I don't put no colors on it. I ain't trying to put nothing, no fringes around it. I'm going to tell you straight up, I will not try and disrespect you. I will give you the respect. But I have to tell you straight up so you can't say, "Well, you didn't." If I tell you, you'll know exactly what I'm saying the way I'm saying it. And that's what I did with him. And any time I needed to talk to him, his office, his dressing room was always open to me. And if I needed to call him, I knew how to get in touch with him. I called him and tell him. That's just simple as that. But I had a good, pretty good working relationship with James. I did.
Do you feel like you were fairly compensated for the amount of creative input that you gave to that group?
Not really. Well...
Let me
put it to you this way.
Okay.
I got paid, and I was basically satisfied with the salary that I was making. But if I had been with I don't know if I need to say it that way or not.
You can say it.
I know I can, but I don't mean to sound disrespectful to anybody or that, but if I had been with a Caucasian group with a name, I would have really, the money would have really been huge. But I'm thankful for what I got. I'm not complaining. I just say at the time that you're doing some things, and then you know for a long time, musicians didn't get any recognition
yes.
for their work. You know, on those that wax and all of that stuff, the covers, they just put whoever the artist name was, and that was it. You didn't get musician didn't get the respect that they would do. You know.
1, 2, 3, 4. Get on up, get up, get on up, stay on the scene, get on up, like a sex machine, get on up, get up, get on up, get up, get on up, stay on the scene, get on up, like a sex machine, get on up, get up, get on up, stay on the scene, get on up, like a sex machine, get on up, wait a minute, shake your arm, then use your palm.
Are there any highlights that stand out in your mind from your time in the James Brown band? Experiences that you hadn't had before, or places that you got to go? Or
oh, well, I went to, when I got with James, I started going to Europe, Africa. I had never been there. I started going to there every year, you know, and I started meeting different people, and we just started, it was certain gigs you started playing, and then when the old band quit James, I'm the only somebody left. And he asked me, he said, well, why did you stay? I said, well, we got a contract. We signed a contract. I signed it, and I was taught, my father taught me from a small kid, if you shake a man's hand or you sign a piece of paper, that you hold on to it. I said, now you broke the contract with long before I didn't break the contract. You did. I said, but that's, I stayed because I got a contract.
How did he break the contract?
Let's don't go into that.
Okay.
It's just a couple of things that happened. I'd much rather not even discuss it.
No problem.
Some things that happened, but that's what happened. And after that, then that's when Bootsy.
Yes.
And this, the group came in. And that was a complete 360 turnaround there.
And they were really young when they got brought in.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Because, see, Jane really hired the group for Bootsy and Phelps, his brother, Catfish.
Mm-hmm, Catfish. That's,
he really hired the band for those two guys. But the other three guys, they came along with the group, so he had to keep them. And for a while they stayed, but then it wasn't that long. But it was really Bootsy and Phelps. You know, because Boosie was, you know, way Boosie, that funk he was playing, man. And then his brother Catfish, man. Hey, they were locked in, man.
And when you left the group, did you know what you wanted to do next?
When I left the group, I went with B.B. King.
Yep.
Because we were in Africa for the Ali and Foreman fight.
Yeah.
And B.B., Sonny Freeman was getting ready to leave the group, and B.B. wanted to know. I'd been knowing B.B. when I first got with Bobby Bland.
Yes.
But he asked me if I would, you know, thought about playing with him, you know. And it was, and at that time, man, it was just about time for me to leave James in a way.
How did your playing style change again when you went back with B.B.?
It never changed. You go back to the blues.
Yeah.
You play the blues. If you play the blues once, you play the blues twice.
Yes.
So I played the blues and then played the funk and then played the blues again. There it was. And that was it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When you left BB's group, then what was your next step?
Mobile, back home.
Mm-hmm.
I was at home and I started playing. I was start playing locally. I started driving tractor and trailer. I was just doing, you know, being at home and doing that, driving and playing on the weekends. I even went with the sheriff department for about 3 years.
What were you doing with them?
In corrections and all that.
Working at the jail?
Huh?
You were like a guard at the jail, or?
I was that, and then I was a transporter. I took guys to prison.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
And how old are your children now?
My daughter is 51. My son is 48.
And are either of them in music?
Huh?
Are either of them in music?
Both of them sang very well. My son started to play drums at a young age, but his instructor committed suicide. He just didn't want to play anymore.
Ah.
Yeah. I got a grandson that plays. He plays drums, and he's into football. He plays piano and in the drum, but he hung up on playing football right now.
And how long have you been married now?
Me?
Yeah.
55 years.
So many of the guys that I talk to have been married 3-4 times or have hard times keeping relationships together.
Don't do that but once, babe. I'm not saying I will or nobody else if something happened to this one. I got married in 1960. I've been married 55 years.
To what do you attribute the strength of your marriage?
Believing in God.
Yeah.
That's believing in God and being able to sit down, because I used to be real chauvinistic. The woman couldn't tell me, it was the way I wanted to be, and that was it. When I married, you can't tell me. I say what it is, and that's the way it is.
How did you learn?
No discussion. I had a mother to tell me right off the bat, who do you think you are? And I wanted to know what she meant. She said, that's a two-way street, buddy. It goes both ways. It's a two-way street. If you saying what you don't want, if she says what she don't want, then what you gonna do? Oh, no. But that's what it was. And then it just took my belief in the Lord, and I had to work at it. Now, sometime right now, it'll jump up, and I'll have to walk up and say, hey, honey, I'm sorry. I apologize, but it takes conversation. You know, like the old school saying is, you don't go to bed angry. I don't do that. We sit up and then we just talk it out. And I have come to, if I see where I'm wrong and she's right, most times she read it most right thing, I go and tell her, hey, I'm sorry, I apologize. She'll tell me the same thing. We do that. But we're going to have problems. If you stay married, you're going to have a problem one way or another. But there's no problem that you can't solve.
Mm.
And we just sit out and talk about it, man. Hey, get it over with. Get it out. Get it over with. Thank you. I'm through with that. Go.
One last thing. So earlier on, you said you've never really felt like you've come into your own. You're always still learning. You're always exploring artistically.
I am.
Do you have any goals moving forward?
No. I just be thankful that I can keep, as long as the good Lord let me keep my health and strength, my mind, and I be able to move, I want to play. I have to play. It's almost, I just have to play. And as long as I can, I will. And whenever I get to the point where I can't play, I won't have no regrets. I just smile and say, boy, I seen the time I did it. And then laugh at it. But that's what I want to do. I want to play. When I'm playing, I am, man, you just don't know the feeling. Because dudes tell you, like, you're going to get hung up on drugs and that's going to make you play. That's the biggest lie in the world. Music makes me high. If I get playing, I love what I'm doing. You can't even get as high as I am.
Mm.
It doesn't take anything if it's in here. It doesn't. If you got music in you,
does that happen every time you sit down to play?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I will. If I don't enjoy it, I am at the point where I don't have to play it.
Mm-hmm.
If I don't enjoy it, I'll walk away. I'll be nice about it. Hey, fellas, thank y'all. I'm sorry. I had enough, and I'll walk away. But basically, I can sit down if they play. I sit down and play. Yes, I love it.
Well, I think that's a great place to end it, and it's been an honor. Jabo Starks, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com.